Hi, everybody. Good evening. Hello, hello. Welcome to this amazing Monday. Snowy evening in Pittsburgh. Oh, if you're just tuning in, we welcome you. Well, make sure that you say hello so that we can all kind of comment back and forth and get engaged and get connected. But hello, I miss many of you. Some of you are remaining behind the scenes. Hi, Christina, hello. Haven't seen a lot of you on, but I have good news. Hi, Paula, nice to see you. Hi, nice to see you. This always freezes up the first 2 minutes, so I'm not gonna say anything of great importance for like 2 minutes. We're just gonna wait for everybody to hop on. We'll take this in stride. Suzanne, nice to see you. How's your husband doing, Suzanne? Hi, Pamela, nice to see you too. Tonight's gonna be a mighty discussion. And I've entitled this, The God That You Wish You Had. And we're gonna be talking about hyper grace. And that God has really, really, really put this on my heart. The subject of the God that you wish you had and hyper grace, because I feel like we're living in a time where, you know, even the churches have watered down the word for the sake of maybe offending man, okay? And we've mistaken the perfect love with the Father for grace. Okay, grace, and what I mean by that is a level of acceptance to the things and the ways of the world that are not a level of acceptance to the ways of our Father, okay? To enlighten you with the topic, even perfect love cast out all fear. That's been on my heart for the past couple days, just that one verse, because God doesn't say love casts out all fear. He says perfect love, okay? Perfect love to God is somebody who is striving to walk in right relationship with the Father. Perfect love goes hand in hand with righteousness and right seeking. It goes hand in hand with the ways of the kingdom. It goes hand in hand with God's decree on man and in your life. And so we're going to go ahead and we're going to read some scripture. We're going to bring it to light. But as you can see, I shared, let me know if you could see it on your end, but I did share our new website that is now up and running. And we have named our ministry Salt of the Earth Ministries, my husband and I. And let me know if you can see the link, because I did link it on here before I started. And if you wish to sow into our ministry, you can go on the website and you can sow right there through PayPal. But we're really excited about this new venture that we're doing with the Lord. I'm not quite too sure where he's leading it, but I'm excited to hit the streets and just go running with the Lord's word, all right? And bringing salvation to all the people that come into our path. And So our website is up and running. If you want to check it out, I did leave a link there. It's Salt of the Earth Ministries at yahoo.us. And so let me know if you can see it there. And you are welcome to share that link with anybody. All of our videos are on there. The Facebook Oasis group was on there if people want to join, and my YouTube channel is also there. And if you go onto our Salt of the Earth Ministries website, you're also going to see the Servant Hearts page, where we have collaborated with a group of people that have a real heart for the Lord, and they are plowing the fields. And we've set up a Meals on Wheels ministry. We have people that you can call behind the scenes that are on this website, and they will pray with you. And so I encourage you to check out the new website that my son did for us. Oh, honey, thank you for sharing that. I did put the link on there. It should be there. I don't know why you might not see it. But anyway, Salt of the Earth Ministries at yahoo.us. So anyway, we're going to really, really hit this thing hard. Yahoo is the email. Trust without you. I'm just, thank you. Salt of the Earth Ministries. .us. Thank you, honey. So, see, I need people behind the scenes to set me straight. But tonight's topic is going to be on hyper grace. All right. Because Christ coming to die for us was not a license to go out and sin and then come back to God and ask for forgiveness and willingly go out and sin again and come back and ask for forgiveness. He did not die so that we would lead a destructive life. Okay, that's not why he died. And so we're going to bridge that gap that I feel like is residing within people, even within churches, because it's hard sometimes to be a Christian because Christians go against the flow of the culture. We don't flow with culture. You know, we are set apart from everybody else. We're very identifiable out in the world. When we are witnessing to others or we're sharing the love and the glory of the Father, there is something unique and different about a Christ follower. You can really, really feel the love. You can feel the purity. You can feel another Christ follower. In fact, the word said, so as he is, so are we. As he is, so are we. We have received that divine nature of Christ when we gave ourselves to him in salvation. We were died, buried, rose again, and that dead sin nature was supposed to come off of us. And we are supposed to rebuke that, renounce that, and walk in favor of the Lord with the willingness to love him and to please him. Okay? If you can even think of the Bible verse that when Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist and the heavens opened up and the glory of the Lord fell upon Jesus and God says, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. Okay. He says that same thing with us. This is my beloved daughter. This is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. Our aim in perfect love cast out all fear. Perfect love is having the willingness to have pleasing lives with the Lord. He will always love us. He will never leave us nor forsake us. However, okay, we know as parents on the other end, you can be not pleased with your son or your daughter, okay? And the last thing we want to do is not have God pleased with us because of a decision that we have made or because we've decided to go in the flow with the culture for fear of offense or for fear that people will think that we don't love them. Okay, how many of you would agree with me if you see your child do a behavior that you know is going to lead to destruction, not just on them, but the people that are watching them and the people of the people of the people, you're going to want to correct your child, okay? And that's the type of Lord that we have. When he sees us veering off the wrong path, when he sees us going in sync with the culture and the ways of the world, he tries to get us back into perfect alignment as we seek him, okay? God does not trespass at all. He does this as we seek him. Okay, and so we're going to go ahead and we're going to read about lawlessness. All right, we're going to read about lawlessness as a Christian because even though we have been redeemed from the curse of the law, that doesn't mean that there is a lawlessness that resides within a Christian. It's not a license. It's not a license to go out and sin willfully. Okay, grace has been imputed to us so that we can come to the Lord when we accidentally slip up. He doesn't, you know, we don't willfully seek to stumble. That's not even scripture. In fact, the Bible says, if you should stumble, if, okay, he doesn't say when, all right, it says if. People think that you cannot walk in a nature without sin. Well, let me tell you, yes, you can, all right, because you have the nature of Christ in you. The people in the Old Testament that had to follow under law, they didn't have the nature of Christ in them. Okay, but we do. And it's that very nature of Christ that gives us the ability to rebuke and renounce the sinful things of man and walk in perfect alignment with the Lord. And so let's go ahead and I'm going to read to you 1 John chapter 2. Now, I entitled this, remember, the God that you wish you had. Okay, and I said that because a lot of people make their own God. Okay, they form him and fashion him into the God that they think he is instead of the God that he is. Okay, they've made their own God and they form that God into their lifestyle. And if their lifestyle isn't conducive to the God that they think he is because of what other people say, what other Christians have said to that person, what other people do, they form their own God without reading the word, without reading truth. Okay, you need the truth because it's the truth that sets you free. It's not the words of other man. Okay, even when I talk to you, I encourage you to read the word of God and not just take verbatim what I say, but to read. So anyway, we're going to go ahead and I'm just going to read with you 1 John chapter 2. And this is all about hyper grace, right? We're going to destroy the works of the devil through him imputing into Christians, into the followers, the need for this hyper grace that we can just do whatever we willfully want because God will forgive us because we want a God that is pleased with us. Oh, he forever loves us. Let's just pray together over this broadcast. Father God, we ask right now that your favor is in the homes residing over the people that are watching this broadcast. In Jesus' name, Lord, I ask you, Lord, that Holy Spirit, that your words are imputed on me and in me, that it is your words that are sanctified, that are going to flow through my voice. Lord, we ask that you deliver the words from me to the people watching that you want them to hear. We ask that you distribute these into their hearts, Lord. Pierce the hearts with the word of God. Pierce the hearts with the sword, with the double-edged sword. We open blind eyes, we open deaf ears, and Lord, we ask you to open all of their hearts with an enormous amount of receiving the glorious riches of their inheritance on earth that you have provided. Give them the will, Lord, and give them the perseverance to run the race with you, Lord, and to understand your grace, your unmerited favor on your children, your heirs. We bring kingdom to earth tonight in this video in Jesus' name. Amen. Hyper grace, the God you wish you had. We're going to start with 1 John chapter 2. And I'm going to read to you chapter 2, verse 1 through 6. Now, I might stop a little bit in between, but I want you to open your ears. I want you to even turn your Bibles. Okay, I'm going to wait a couple seconds. Turn your Bibles to 1 John, not just John, 1 John chapter 2. Because I want you to see these words. I want these words that you hear them, that you see them. I want them to jump off the paper into your heart. Okay, take responsibility for what's happening tonight. Okay, as sons and daughters of the glory of God on high, take responsibility, open the word of God. 1 John chapter 2. My dear children, okay, so he's already talking to the people that are walking in the glory of the Lord. They're already his children, so these people have already been saved, all right? So he's talking to the people that have an inheritance of heaven. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. I write this to you so that you will not sin. Okay, he doesn't say so that I hope that you don't, so that I know that it's going to be hard for you. No, he says, I'm writing this to you so that you will not. There's an expectation that is in place from our Father. Okay, so that you will not sin. But if anybody does, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sin, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the world. So he's setting a stage here and he says, I write this so that you will not sin, but if you do, if you have an accident and you do something that you know isn't pleasing to your Father, there's an advocate that is in place. We have an advocate that is the Holy Spirit, okay? He is the advocate, Father, Son, Holy Ghost, the righteous one. Verse 3, we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commands. We know that we have come to know the Lord if we keep his commands. Many people will say that they are Christ followers, that they know Jesus, but yet they're out doing activities that might not be pleasing with the Father. If you know the Father, if you know the Father on an intimate level, you get perfect love for him. Okay, back to the verse that we talked about. Perfect love cast out all fear. All fear. Okay, perfect love in the Father is knowing the truth that sets you free. Perfect love in the Father is knowing the truth that sets you free, which keeps you in obedience with him, which keeps you in line with his commands. Do you guys follow me? Okay, so he says, we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commands. Whoever says, I know him, but does not do what he commands is a liar. And the truth is not in that person. But whoever obeys his word, love for God is truly in them. This is how we know we are in him. Whoever claims to live in him must live as Jesus did. Whoever claims to be a Christ follower, an heir of the kingdom, one with the Lord, must live as Jesus did. All right. Now, we might ask ourselves, is that a really difficult thing to do? Can we really live as Jesus did? Yes. Okay. He's not going to give us a task that we cannot carry out because you're filled with the goodness and the glory of Jesus' Spirit, of the Holy Spirit. And we know that because it tells us that in a couple scriptures. Preferably, I want to read to you 2 Peter. We're going to go ahead to 2 Peter Chapter 1, verses 3 through 4. 2 Peter chapter 1, we're going to start with verse 3. I'll give you a couple minutes to go there. But in this content, he's talking about how we have his divine nature in us. Because we have been baptized, because we have died, buried, we are dead to that sin thing, and we rose again. We have this new nature and oneness with the Lord because we're walking with the Holy Spirit in us and on us and around us all the time to keep us in alignment as we seek the Father. As we seek him, if we are not seeking him through our daily lives, okay, we fall out of alignment and we start down other paths and we start going towards the ways of the world. And we're going to touch on that in another scripture. But 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, he says, his divine power, okay, power has given us everything we need for godly life through our knowledge of him. So you have to know him to be walking in this nature of God, right? Who called us by his own glory and goodness. So he called you. Okay, he has had a calling on your life to get you to this video. He's had a calling on your life to get you in the water, to get baptized, to get filled with the Holy Spirit. He chose you before the world was made, before you ever chose him. You were chosen by God as an heir, and you are special. Okay, you're very special and very, very loved. Verse 4, through these, he has given us his very great and precious promises, so that through them, okay, through the promises, you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. Because you carry Christ's divine nature, you no longer long for the things of the world and the evil desires because you have his very nature in you. Hi, how are you guys doing? I see some fun. Mary Frame, hi, it's nice to see you. For this reason, let's go to verse 5. For this reason, make every effort to add to your faith. Okay, so add this to your faith. Goodness, and to goodness, knowledge, and to knowledge, self-control. And to self-control, perseverance, and to perseverance, godliness, and to godliness, mutual affection, and to mutual affection, love. These are things that are said in 2 Peter. This is said by Simon Peter, okay? This is Peter who denied Christ 3 times, all right? He's the one that really, really messed up, but then in the end, he really, really got it right, all right? Everybody focuses on the mess up, all right? But man, I mean, look what he has done for the kingdom. And he says to you, for this reason, to make an effort to add goodness to your faith, self-control, perseverance, godliness, to add this to your faith. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. They will keep you from sinning. If you are seeking these things, because the Holy Spirit gives without measure upon your life. So let's just prophesy this verse over you on this broadcast. I'm going to pray this over you and prophesy the word of God over you. We're just going to read this scripture, and then we're going to put the Oasis group in with this content, and we're going to ask for the glory of the Lord to take you from glory to glory. So Father God, right now, we ask you in Jesus' name that your divine nature accelerate over this broadcast into the body of believers that are on here, that it accelerates to the people that are listening now and to the ones that are going to play the replay. Lord, we ask for this acceleration in this beautiful alignment in your spirit, that you are setting them on the right path, and that their families are aligning behind them on the path because they are seeking you in that secret place, Lord. We ask for perseverance over this broadcast. We ask for self-control imputed through this broadcast. We ask for a supernatural faith. We ask for supernatural faith. Father God, we ask for godliness, mutual affection, a mutual affection for the people that are around them, and the perfect love that you are seeking, Lord. We ask you to quicken their spirits, to quicken their hearts, to have a knowing and the knowledge and the wisdom of what perfect love to you, Lord, looks like. We ask you to form them, to fashion them, to mold them into the people that you are likening them to be, that you are the Father that looks at this broadcast and looks at everybody on here and says, this is my son, this is my daughter in whom I am well pleased. In Jesus' name. Oh gosh, God is moving. God is moving in a mighty, mighty way. 1 John, I'm going to take you to 1 John chapter 3, and I'm going to share with you what the Lord says about lawlessness. 1 John chapter 3, and I'm going to start with verse 7, but the beginning of the chapter is about the love of God that he has lavished on us. Okay, and we're heading into Valentine's Day. Studying the love of the Father is fascinating to me. He has more love than you can ever, ever, ever imagine. And so let's go to 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3. And he's talking again to his children. Okay, he says, dear children, do not let anyone lead you astray. He says, don't let anybody lead you astray. The one who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The one who does what is sinful is of the devil, because the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the devil's work. Okay? The reason why the Son of God appeared was to destroy the works of the devil. When we gave ourselves to the Lord and we were died, buried, rose again, that sin nature died. It's done. It's dead. Okay, so anybody that comes to us and says, you know, you're once a sinner, always a sinner, that's not what my Bible tells me. Okay, I was a sinner and I'm saved by grace. And he says, if you should stumble, if you should sin, this is what you do. Okay, all right, let's read further because he goes on to talk. He says, verse 9, no one who is born of God will continue to sin. No one who's born of God will continue to sin. Why? Why? Because when you have perfect love for the Father, the last thing you want to do is disappoint Him. It's a heart relationship. It's a heart relationship. It's the same relationship that we have with our own children. Our own children. It's the same relationship that you might have with your spouse that is really, really close to you. But He says, if you, why? Because God's seed remains in them. They cannot go on sinning. Cannot go on sinning because they have been born of God. This is how we know and who the children of the devil are. Anyone who does not love their brother and sister. Verse 9. No one who's born of God will continue to sin. They cannot go on sinning. God's seed remains in them. They cannot. A lion cannot give birth to a fish. Okay, when we gave ourselves to the Lord, we were died, buried, rose again. There's a new birth that happened. Okay, when that seed is watered, that's what the Bible, as you gain in knowledge in the knowing of your Father, okay, as you gain in wisdom, as you grow in your faith, the seed is getting watered. Therefore, you don't want to not please Him, and it's not your will to want to. I know that we keep cutting out. I can see it on my end, so I'm paused. Is this something new that you are learning tonight? Is this something new? Because in many of the places that I have traveled, I have heard this was a big eye opener for me. A really, really big eye-opener for me. And I pray that it is really, really piercing your heart and pure, very clear. And it says, no one who's born of God will continue to sin because God, this is how we know that they are children of God. I'm going to encourage you to just read the book of 1 John. Read the book of 1. We have the Gospel of John. Then we have 1 John. Then we have 2 John. And then we have over and over. Scripture. We're going to go to Luke 24, verse 44. This might be part of my favorite section in the Bible. Chapter 24. Go to Luke 24, verse 44 with me. Luke 24, 44. And this is what he says. He said to them, this is what I told you through the Lord. So I froze a couple minutes. So you missed nothing. Did you guys go to Luke? Did you guys go to the book of Luke? 24. Go to Luke 24. Verse 44, Jesus is talking. He says, this is what I told you while I was still with you. So this is Jesus has died. He's rose again. All right. And he's come to the disciples. All right. He's rose from the dead. And now he's sitting with the disciples. And this is what he says to them. He says, everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms. Now listen to what Jesus does. He says, then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. All right. Then Jesus opened their minds so they can understand the scriptures. This is why it's so vital that somebody who wants to know the Lord Jesus Christ get baptized. All right. Because when the Holy Spirit comes and makes his home and plants his seed inside that person, the Holy Spirit who wrote the Bible aids with you in learning how to read it and how to interpret it. And we just read it that Jesus opens up the minds of the disciples. He opens up their minds so they can understand scriptures. And he, this is what he says to them. The Messiah will suffer, rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. Now he says, I'm going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you've been clothed with power from on high. So he opens up their minds so they can understand scripture. And then he tells them, I want you to stay in the city. Okay, stay in the city until you're clothed in power from on high. Were they already saved? They were already saved, but they were not clothed in power because Jesus had not yet went to the Father. We're going to bring this together with John chapter 19, when Jesus breathes on them. Now, there's a reason why I'm taking you here as we talk about the word grace. John 19. Hold on a second. Hold on. Okay. Oh, I love this. All right. So, John chapter 20. And let's start with verse 19. Jesus is appearing to the disciples and they are in this locked room. All right, they're in this locked room and all of a sudden this dead person who is alive, all right, they watched him die on the cross. They're in this locked room because they're afraid for their life. The disciples are in this room, they're scared, and Jesus shows up in this locked room. And so here's what he says to them, verse 19. Chapter 20 in the book of John. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them. Peace be with you. After he said this and his side, the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I'm sending you. So he's commissioning them to go out and tell the world about him. Then it says, and with that, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. He breathes on them and he says, receive the Holy Spirit. All right. So we have Jesus before he ascends to the Father. He says, he breathes on them. He says, receive the Holy Spirit. In the book of John, it says, I want you to wait in Jerusalem for the promised Holy Spirit. So they were already saved. Jesus breathed the Holy Spirit on them, but they were not clothed in power. They were not clothed in power yet. Okay? And then when you read the book of Acts, that Holy Ghost comes and it comes in fire and they see tongues of fire and everybody begins speaking in the heavenly language and now they're clothed in power from on high. Friends, this is part of the divine nature of Christ. Being clothed, not just saved for salvation, but clothed in his glorious riches and inheritance on earth, which is the power of God, that seed in you. The same God, the same Holy Spirit that rose Jesus from the dead lives in you. And God sends us out and he says, go out, make disciples. He says, heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, freely receive this power I give you and freely give. Many Christians are walking without power. They're walking without the divine full nature of Christ. It's one thing to mindfully know of Christ and to read the word of God and have Holy Spirit in you, but to have the divine nature of the Holy Spirit's power resting upon you, all right, is another thing. All right, and we have studied this when we studied about the Holy Spirit and about the gift of speaking in tongues. And if you did not see that video, I encourage you to go on my YouTube channel, okay, through our Salt of the Earth Ministries link, and it's on there. But when you are clothed in power from on high, folks, it enables you to walk in the divine nature of Christ, and it helps you stay on the path that Jesus is putting you on, as long as you are seeking him. Okay, it's not a one and done. It's not a one and done thing where, okay, I did this, I received that, now I'm never going to sin. The Bible clearly says that as you seek him, and I'm actually going to read that to you, because it's important that we know the nature and the nurture of our Lord. So I'm going to read to you 2 Chronicles. I'm going to give you some Old Testament because I like to collide the Old Testament with the New Testament. They're all important. I'm going to read to you from 2 Chronicles to give you the backstory of what I'm going to deliver to you. Solomon's temple has just been built, and the Lord comes to speak to Solomon, and this is what he says. Now, I find this important to share with you because Solomon's temple has been built. This temple is housing God. Your temple was built, and it's housing God. Okay? This is what the Lord says to Solomon in 2 Chronicles. He appears to him and speaks. This is quote unquote God speaking. When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command locusts to devour the land, or send a plague among my people. Okay, so these are the people that were supposed, these were the people that were following God, or command locusts to devour the land, or send a plague among my people. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land. Now, most people know that much, but I'm going to take you one verse over, okay, because it's very important. He says, now my eyes will be open. This is God. Now my eyes will be open and my ears will be attentive to the prayers offered in this place, in the temple. You are that temple now. So if you are seeking, praying, seeking his face, turning from your sinful nature and holy repentance, he says his eyes will be attentive to us. And the prayers offered, I have chosen and consecrated this temple so that my name may be there forever. That's us, okay? My eyes and my heart will always be there. I have chosen and consecrated this temple so that my name may be there forever. My eyes and my heart will always be there. Your body is the temple. What God sees, this is what God sees when you are born again. Okay? He says to turn away from your wicked ways. All right? We don't need to exchange evil for evil. We exchange evil for good. Okay, if someone's being evil, that is the heart nature of the Father, okay, or, okay, we did a video about 2 weeks ago on righteous anger. That is on the YouTube channel through our website. And so there is a time for righteous anger, but we must be able to differentiate the two, okay, between the righteous anger and, honestly, I hate to use the word holiness, but living in the holiness that is pleasing to our Lord. And I think that that word scares a lot of people on what that looks like. But all it is reading his word, spending time with him, having a heart and a love for the Father, and asking the Lord, God, what is it that you want from me today? What is it that you want from me today? What can I do for you? I sometimes ask him, what are you doing? Like, what are you doing right now? You know, what's up? I talk to him just like I'm talking with you. All right, but that's how intimacy is built. That's transparent, being transparent with the Father. He already knows anyway, okay? He already knows. But I love 2 Chronicles chapter 13, chapter 7, 13 through 16. That's what we read, 2 Chronicles. And I'm going to encourage you to camp there and just say to the Lord, Father God, we seek your face. We humble ourselves and we pray and we seek your face even in this broadcast. We turn from all of our wicked ways, Lord. If there is a wicked seed or a wicked way about us, we ask you, Lord, to reveal it. And we ask you to put it on the table and draw it to surface. We ask you, Lord, to dredge that thing out and remove it. Anything wicked among this group, Lord, we ask that your hand come down from the throne room and yank that thing out and replace it, Lord, with a victorious, mighty replacement of the Holy Spirit. We ask that it embarks on this channel and just an explosion goes off in people's hearts. For you are love. We ask that your love be transparent through the people that are watching this broadcast, through the God chasers that are chasing you with a vengeance. We ask you, Lord, that you are raising up mighty soldiers in victory that will never be victims on earth, but they are soldiers and ambassadors for Christ. In Jesus' name. Your body is the temple that houses the mighty Holy Spirit, waiting to bust at the seams, because God is waiting for man to become manifest on earth, to walk in his glory, okay, to further the kingdom. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We say that prayer probably over every, but there is no sickness in heaven. There is no disease. There is no COVID. And the person receiving that makes that thing go, okay, that makes that leave, is going. All right, we're setting the stage for the temple. We're creating what great men, because this is what we do in this broadcast, is we live in the Word. And so we're going to Romans 6, and I'm going to read you Romans 6, 1 through 4. And you're at school? At Bible college, you're struggling with fear. I'm going to pray with you over this broadcast, Abigail. But stay close to the people, you know, with a leader and an elder who can help mentor you as you're there, Abigail. In the name of Jesus, right now, we ask that the perfect love be molded and fashioned with Abigail. She has an everlasting love for you, Lord. We command the spirit of fear to leave. The spirit of fear to leave, that the thoughts of our past, we loose the thoughts of the past right now, of past sickness and heartache, we loose it, we command it to leave. We open the trap and the snare of the enemy right now. As saying, may your glory rest on Abigail tonight, in Jesus' name. Okay. I'm sin alive in Christ. Folks, if you're just tuning in, we're talking about grace. We're talking about, okay, because people mold and make God into a God that he's grace. Verse 1. And so the people say, they say, what shall we say then to the church in Rome? And he says, shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. Paul says, we are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Jesus, we're baptized into his death. We were therefore buried with him through baptism in death, in order that, just as of the Father, we too may live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, being reunited with Christ in a resurrection like his is being Christ-like, so that the body ruled by sin may be done away with it. So the body that was ruled by sin is done away with it. Your sin nature no longer wants to take on the tasks of sinning. Those who continue to, you know, to get off that path, or they continue to stumble, very, very important that they get in that secret place with the Lord, and they are resting in Him through praise and worship, through the mighty word of the Lord, and really getting deep with Him to keep them from stumbling, because the Bible is clear. It's clear that God has equipped us with His nature so that we do away with the sin and we don't even want to engage in it. Amen. Okay. Galatians. I love Galatians. Let's go to Galatians tonight. Love it. I think we should just do a whole study on this broadcast and just stay in Galatians. Maybe we'll start doing that. But I'm going to take you to Galatians chapter 5 and verse 19. Now, I like this because, you know, he's talking to a church in Galatia, and he says, Paul, again, says the acts of the flesh. Now, he's talking about the acts of the flesh. He doesn't say that this is a spirit doing this to people. He says this is the acts of the flesh. In other words, you have a conscience. You do have a choice. You know, people always say the devil made me do it. Well, no, don't give him so much credit. You have a mind, you have a soul, you have a body, and you do have a certain level of control. Okay, don't give the devil that kind of credit. All right, don't give that to him. You are the promised seed of the Father. You have the glory of the Lord in you. And it says that the glory of the Lord helps you persevere for the things of God as you're seeking Him, as you're seeking Him. But Galatians chapter 5, verse 19 says, the acts of the flesh are obvious. The acts of the flesh are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry. Now, idolatry can be anything that you are seeking outside of seeking the Father for comfort. Okay? That becomes one's idol. Okay? It becomes the thing that we worship. Okay? That becomes the thing that we worship. It's not necessarily a figure that you make that you bow to. All right? It's the thing that you are spending all of your time on that is taking you off the path with the Father. Idolatry and witchcraft. Hatred. Hatred is of the flesh. Discord. Jealousy. Fits of rage. Selfish ambition. Selfish ambition. What is driving you? What is your motive? Is it a selfish gain? Is it to further the kingdom, or is it to further recognition for oneself? Self-ambition. We will be judged by our hearts. The Bible says that. We're all going to be judged. And God looks at the heart of His follower to see the why behind what they're doing. Okay? So selfish ambition is of the flesh. Dissensions, factions, and envy. Envy, okay? It's of the flesh and it's wrong, okay? We do not need to strive to be like somebody else or to have what somebody else has or to have a gift like somebody else has, okay? That's envy. Drunkenness, all right? It's not pleasing to the Lord. He doesn't like it. Orgies and the like. He says, I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. He says, if you live like this, all right, now he's talking to the church. These people are saved. All right, he says, if you live like this, you will not inherit the kingdom of God. Then he goes on, he says, but the fruit of the Spirit. So the fruit of having the promised seed in you and that seed being watered and growing, this is the fruit of it. Love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. You've made a decision to partner and co-labor with the Lord, and you've crucified the flesh. It's done. It's dead. Okay? You're alive in Christ. You've been given a new spirit. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking, and envying of each other. Walk by the Spirit, being Spirit-led. Okay, letting the Spirit lead us and guide us before we make any decisions ourselves, or before we help our children make any decisions for their future. Before I even got on this broadcast, it was all about, God, what do you want? What do you want? I didn't get anything till almost 6:20. I was going crazy. You know, all week I try to plan for this Monday night, and I try to plan for Thursday night in our home, and it just happened at 6:20. It all started to fall in order because, people, we're seeking the mind of the Father. What do you want? What do people need to hear? Who am I going to walk into at the grocery store? Lord, do you have a word for me before I go to Giant Eagle? Do you have a word? I'll never forget, before I went out, I had a word, and it was a checkerboard. All right, it was a checkerboard. And I went to Advance Auto Parts because it has a checkerboard on the sign. I drove by it on my way to my destination and went in there and got to witness to some people. And it was an amazing, there was an anointing all over. It was amazing. Just ask the Father, okay? I'm not doing anything incredible that you are not already, you know, gifted in doing. The Bible says that my sheep will hear my voice. Okay, that's you. You should be able to know the will of the Father, okay? You should be able to hear it, know it, write it down. It's amazing. Absolutely amazing. Okay. So we went over the list of fleshy sins. They're fleshy sins. Keeping God's commandments means we go against the flow of the culture. Love is truth. The Bible never says that love is nice. Okay. Love is truth. All right. In fact, the Bible says that love is the perfect love will cast out all fear. It doesn't just say love. And so, you know, God does have a list of commandments in his culture for his people so that we live a life that is not destructive and a life that is pleasing to the Father. When you live a life of this way, you begin to produce fruit that people want to pick from you. Amen. 2 John verse 6, and this is love, that we walk in obedience to his commands. Okay, so he's telling us what love is to God, that we walk in obedience to his commands. As you have heard from the beginning, his command is that you walk in love. But walking in love means that we're walking not just to love our neighbor, but we're walking in obedience to God's commands. Okay, and now I'm going to leave you with two more verses. We're going to go to Ephesians chapter 2. And Ephesians chapter 2 is all about dying to the worldly sins. I need to get up close to my camera because I see. I won't even give them a capital. Hello. Amen, Kathy. Merle, you're hysterical. That's right, Jeff. Amen. That's right, Merle. Fear, false evidence appearing real. That's right. Amen. Cindy! Oh my gosh, from Hawaii. What are you doing? That guy give me... You're welcome, Mary. You're so welcome. So welcome. All right, I'm going to take you to Ephesians chapter 2. And I know that this is a lot tonight, you know, but, you know, hang in there. All right. The Lord wants to download a lot into you. Maybe you can play the replay and really, really prophesy these scriptures over yourself so that you can go, you know, in his kingdom, that you can go from glory to glory. If you are where you were a year ago, you know, with the Lord, we want to get you accelerated. We want you to have exponential growth. Amen. We want you to grow in your giftings from the Lord. We want you to grow in your relationship with the Lord. That is this ministry, Salt of the Earth Ministries, .us. Okay, and so go on, check out our website, go on our YouTube channel and subscribe, and you'll be able to share these videos with friends, because it isolates the conversations that are running through this video. That's all dubbed out. So you're able to share this with other people. Okay, Ephesians 2, enjoying my friend Cindy. I love you. Oh, nice to see you. Okay, Ephesians chapter 2. Let's read this together, okay? I'm going to read you 1 through 22. So just hang in there, okay? Maybe, you know, read along. And if your Bible isn't open, just soak this up. Soak up the words from the Lord, because this chapter is mighty. He says, Paul was talking to the church in Ephesus. These are Christians, okay? It's so important that you understand why these letters are written. Who is he talking to? All right? So important. All right. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of the world and of the ruler of the kingdom of air. The ways of the world, the ruler of the kingdom of air, is Satan himself. That's the ruler of air. The spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. Notice in your Bible that that word spirit is not capitalized, because it's not the Holy Spirit. Okay? The spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. It's not Holy Spirit. It's a soulish spirit. All of us also lived among them at one time. So everybody has been there before they gave themselves to Christ, gratifying in the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who's rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. Okay, it is by grace you have been saved. You have done nothing to earn it. It's unmerited favor that God sought you out, wrote your name in the Lamb's Book of Life, gave you a free entrance into heaven. Amen. It is through this grace that you have been saved, but he has also given you grace and power to live as the seed is in you, the divine nature of Christ, that you walk in power in the divine nature of Jesus on earth, completely set apart from the rest of the culture. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in heavenly realms in Christ Jesus. He seated us in heavenly realms, okay? That's important that you understand what heavenly realms is. Okay, there are things that are happening in the heavenly realms that enable us, all right, to lay hands on the sick and they will recover. Okay, he is ministering angels going to and fro, working on our behalf so that the Holy Spirit, we are used as a walking power plant doing God's work on earth. Okay, because everything happens through prayer and nothing without it, and everything happens through these little temples. I call them little tiny power plants. Okay, we're like a conduit when we go up to people, because you have Jesus Christ in you, the hope of glory. Okay, and he has seated in heavenly realms in Christ Jesus in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace. There's that word grace again, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. For it has been by grace you have been saved through faith. That word saved in the Greek is sozo, which means healed, delivered, set free, no longer in bondage, healed, okay? Healed from sickness, healed from disease. But then it says through faith. So it's through your faith that you are saved in this way, okay? So you have to have the faith to back up that saved. And this is not from yourselves. It's a gift from God. It's a gift from God that he bestows on you, okay? It's another asset for you as you're on earth, all right? You're not just being saved to go to heaven, all right? If all we did was be saved to go to heaven, we would have been baptized, and then we would have died and went to heaven, all right? But he has us baptized in him and has us walking on earth with this gift, okay, so that we can further his kingdom here on earth. And then he says, this is not from yourselves, it's a gift from God, not by works, so that no one can boast. We're God's handiwork, created in Christ to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. In advance, he's already prepared the good work that he wants to do in you and through you. I think that we're gonna leave it there. We're gonna leave it there because that's about where I wanted to go. We're just gonna stop there. But through faith, you have been saved. So it is by grace you have been saved. Amen. Okay, we're gonna wrap this up with Matthew 7. Matthew 7. And I'm going to read this to you in Matthew 7, where it says, not everybody who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Okay, now I'm narrating this. If you want to go to this, you can read it. But in Matthew chapter 7, Jesus's followers come to him. They have been healing the sick. They have been raising the dead. They have been doing all of the works with the power of the Holy Spirit in them and upon them. And they come to Jesus and they say, you know, Lord, Lord, Jesus says to them, not everybody who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. And he said that they will say, well, didn't we do this? Didn't we heal the sick? Didn't we raise the dead? Didn't we do that? And he will look at them and he will say, away from me, you who practice lawlessness. Okay, and if you are just joining in, you're going to want to play the beginning of this video because we basically talked about lawlessness, all right? Because what we're addressing tonight is hyper-grace. Hyper-grace. It's very destructive. It's very misleading to the world on what God's people are supposed to look like, what we are supposed to look like and practice and partner and co-labor with our Lord. Okay, he will look at you because he's examining the heart of man. You know, in other words, he's going to ask you, what were your intentions in doing it? Was it to build yourself up? Was it to be known? You know, what were your intentions? They're going to say, Lord, Lord, we did all this in your name. We even said your name. And he's going to say, away from me, you who practice lawlessness. So they were doing all of these good deeds for Jesus, but then behind the scenes, they were willfully seeking the desires of the flesh. When God has strictly really commanded us to die to the things of the flesh. So I just want to pray over you tonight that this really, really, really did something to build your spirit. That you have went from glory to glory in this broadcast. And I'm going to encourage you to go to saltoftheearthministries.org. If you want to sow into this ministry, you know, we're longing to just really bust out of just doing videos. And, you know, whatever God's plan and purpose, I know that he has one. I ask you to pray for me. Saints on the other end, that you pray for me, that I clearly hear the voice of the Lord and that I am following the directions of his heart. And I pray that these videos are glorifying you as well. So Lord, We pray over this entire broadcast, everybody in this Oasis group and on the Bold, the Brave, the Believer page, Lord. We pray over Salt of the Earth Ministries that your will be made manifest over it. And Father God, we pray over everybody's fleshy desires. If anybody is on this broadcast and they are feeling guilt, shame, or condemnation, that is not the nature of our Lord. That is a lie from the enemy. And so we command that thing to die right now. We thank you, Lord, that you have a forgiving heart, that we can come to you at any time when we catch ourselves up into a sinful fleshy desire, and we can bring it to you. We lay all of our desires that are not holy and are not of you, Lord. We lay them at your altar right now. We lay them at your feet. We ask you, Lord, to pick them up and to get rid of it and to instill the divine nature of Christ in a mighty new way tonight over everybody on this broadcast. Anybody who is suffering at all with a sinus infection, in the name of Jesus, Father God, we ask that your living water flow through there, and that you, just like you breathed in the disciples that we talked about earlier, that you are breathing this fresh new air up their nose, up their nostrils, in the name of Jesus, and that they have a clear head tonight, no fogginess. And we command all that to die in the name of Jesus. Lord, we glorify you. We love you with all of our hearts, all of our souls, all of our minds. And we entrust our entire life in your hands. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Our church has been rebuilt in our home. It's completely done. So I'm really excited for Thursday. If you've not come yet, we encourage you to. We're in John chapter 4. We're starting John chapter 4 on Thursday night. And so we'll see you then. And again, check out our new website, saltoftheearthministries.org. And if you feel that this has blessed you, you're welcome to sow in our ministry. So I will see you, many of you, on Thursday, and I'll see you next Monday. Amen. Love you all. Bye.